Good morning, friends. Good noon, rather. And I hope that all of you are doing well in these times, in those COVID times, and you are healthy, hale and hearty, and you are taking all the precautions. Because this is the time to take precautions, and we need not take any kind of chances, even with the markets. So, friends, we do not have US markets as the only barometer for our markets, or let's say direction. So apart from the fact that we follow US markets on a day-to-day basis also, but there's no direct 100% relationship. In fact, if you were to look at the last 2 years, you would find that the relationship is around 38%. So while we do get impacted, but our markets also have their ability to move against the tide. But the overall trend, which while we may have only 38% of, let's say, connection with the US markets, but the fact is that our markets or global markets are impacted by the US Federal Reserve and the policies of the US. There is nothing to, let's say, go away from this truth. So let's look at how we are connected and why US markets are important. So next slide, Shyam. Obviously today US is the world's largest economy and the only superpower, if you can call so. The trade policy of the US impacts the rest of the world. So US is very important from that perspective. The US has military presence in more than 80 countries across the globe, while it will have a military person in almost 150 countries, but there is a significant presence in 80 countries. The US Federal Reserve, we all know, sets the trend for interest rates and liquidity in the global markets. And as we have known earlier, you can't fight the Fed. So to that extent, it is the super powerful as far as the anything, if you were to call something most important, then it is the US Federal Reserve, which impacts the rest of the global markets. US also prints the reserve currency of the world, that is the US dollar. Till some other currency comes up, I mean, this is the currency. The US also accounts for more than 55% of the world's capital market overall. So if the US sneezes, the rest of the world does catch cold. The rest of the global markets have a direct relationship with the US markets, but as I said, the relationship exists, but it is not 100%. In our case, it is 38%. So we now move to the next slide. Yes. Now, here is what we see in... can we move back one slide, please? Yeah. Okay, next slide now. Yeah, okay. Yeah, next slide. Yeah. Here is, you have... we have Trump, Obama for the last two sessions, and then you have again Mr. Bush. So we have had, Obama was Republican, the two are, let's say Obama was a Democrat and the other two are Republicans. Now, the perception is that the Republicans are market friendly and the Democrats are not. Okay, this is the public perception. Now let's look at how the US markets behaved 1 month, that is from the, if you can't count 31st of October till about 30th November, the markets in 1 month, in the cases of Trump, have gone up by 5.14%. And in Obama, there were two instances. One, they went up, in another, they came down. But if you look at 3 months, then Obama's first tenure was a washout. But the in the rest of the other instances, we see a positive flow of the markets. So the first 3 months could at the most be crucial. That's all. And there is no need to worry about a US presidency beyond those 3 months. If you look at a 1 year, then the things even out. And if you look at the whole tenure, then things even out further. But in case of Bush, Bush had the disadvantage of having the 2008 crisis during his tenure. So therefore, the market stand at that point of time. So they have taken away all the last 1 year has taken away all the good work that Bush did for his tenure. So this is as far as the markets are concerned. Now let's go to the next slide. Now today there is a rapper also in the fray, but let's count him out. There are two serious contenders, obviously the incumbent president Mr. Trump and the erstwhile Joe Biden, who was the vice president at that point of time during Obama's tenure. He is now running for the presidentship from the Democrat side. Now, Mr. Trump has already reduced the corporate taxes, and now he further wants to reduce the top end of the taxes of the individuals from 39.6% to 37%. Trump is also a staunch India supporter and also very vocal anti-China. Mr. Biden, on the other hand, wants to increase the corporate taxes from 21%, the current what he had brought down, Trump, he wants to increase to 28% and increase the expenditure on infrastructure, so public spending, by giving more taxes. So these are the two candidates, and this is their stance. Now, obviously, for the markets, the first stance of Trump, if Trump comes back, it is good. Biden comes back, it is bad for the markets. But in the overall, then we'll conclude at the end of the session that nothing is as sacrosanct as these things, because barring the first 3 months, it doesn't really matter who's at the helm. Okay, so now let's go to the next slide. Sham. See, lower corporate taxes puts money into the hands of the companies and the shareholders, and it is good for the markets in the short run. So a Trump win augurs well for the markets in the short run and spells continuity of the regime. Just 1 second, sir. Pardon me, 1 second. Yes, sir, I'm back. So Biden can pull down the markets in the short run, because if he is going to win, he's being back, he's going to hike the taxes, which will in turn will spoil the capital markets. But a significant infrastructure spending thereafter, when he enters, can result into better markets in the long run. Okay, next slide, Sham. Now, how are things stacked up? Let's see that. Sorry, one second. Now, Biden has taken a considerable lead of 10 percentage points between the two. But that does not guarantee a win for Biden, even if the current trends were to hold. This is because in all but two states, the winner takes its all. So while there is a popular vote, but that popular vote is for the representatives, 430 odd of the Congress and 105 of 35 of the Senate. So essentially, these are the people who are going to, this electoral college is going to actually go out and elect the president. So the swing states of Arizona, Florida, Ohio, Michigan, and Pennsylvania can make all the difference. Okay. Next slide, Shyam. Winning popular vote doesn't make one president. Okay. Let's take Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton led from the beginning, Trump. Even she was leading in all the debates, and even going into the elections, she was leading. There were no two doubts about it. But ultimately, Mr. Trump won because despite winning the popular vote of 48.2% compared to Donald Trump's, which is, this works out to something like 46.1%, she lost because the states, even so, those states where there were more number of electoral seats, he won by a thinner margin. I mean, he won those states, Trump. So his winning of those states turned out into higher electoral votes by which he got elected as a president. The same may happen, may not happen, or it may happen for Biden also. So currently, while it may seem so that Trump is built absolutely behind, it may not be so. Okay, actually result may be very, very different. So, but currently, if you were to make a guess, obviously you'll have to go with the trend and saying that probably Biden will come in. Okay. Now, so last time Trump got 304 and 227 were by Miss Hillary Clinton. So she lost. Next slide. Now, what is at stake for India? While we are worried about the markets, but we need to look at our country as well. See, Trump wears his India love on his sleeve. He calls Mr. Modi a friend. He has gone out of his way to warn China. The Secretary of State also of the US has done in as many words. And they have made it very, very clear when, if at all, in US has to take a position, it will be in favor of India if there is a tiff against China. So he is pro-India and absolutely anti-China. India can harp on American support in the event of a war with China if he is there. If he is not there, then the chances are slightly less. Biden, on the other hand, as a senator in the 1990s, stalled the Russian cryogenic engines for our nuclear program, which set us back by many, many years. Same China was buying those Russian engines, but was allowed, and Biden, as a senator, was responsible for holding, for making that litigation to spoil the agreement by which Russia could supply. So Russia had to backtrack at that point of time. So the one man who was singularly responsible was Joe Biden, who was a senator at that point of time. Biden also has a pro, he is not purely for Americans. He has a soft corner for all the people who have come from outside also. And therefore, he can go soft on China and Pakistan, which may not augur well for India. Okay. However, we need to understand and very thoroughly that the Chinese policy is not the American policy is not only a function of who the president is, but it is governed by the institutions in the US, which are the army, which are the Navy, and which is the CIA and the other deep state. So Russia is at this point of time, let's look at leave India aside. If you look at grossly at the other instance of China, and let's see US reaction to that. The fact that a quad has been made with Australia, Japan, China, Australia, Japan, India, and the US, it virtually ties the US to Indian relations. Even if Biden wants, he cannot go back. That's our take. Secondly, US wants China to be curtailed. So therefore, if there is a war, I still feel that there would be US will have to take sides, and those sides will be along with India. So there are no two doubts about it now. So as far as this is concerned, it doesn't change a change in the presidentship. In case it happens, doesn't change anything for us. Let's go to the next slide. Now, there are many things, there are many sectors which are impacted, but largely the main impact is on the pharma, the IT, and the aerospace and defense sector. So let's come to pharma first. In this pharma's in this age, I think if you look at the last 6 months, you have seen that the US FDA has slightly gone easier on clearances from India, and therefore those clearances for the various projects have come quite fast, largely after the fact that India exported penicillin to the US and other countries when it was required, and India has appeared as a country which has helped others. And therefore, at a time when it was so much needed, so from that point of view, the US FDA today is slightly more proactive towards India and looks at India in a slightly better light. However, we need not harp on this, because part of the delay in any kind of, let's say, negative action could also be because of the COVID, that the inspections were not to that extent. So therefore, we believe that suffice to say that one need not take the current attitude of the US FDA as something which is going to be permanent. No, it can change, but the fact is Indian pharma is better placed today than it was earlier, because of the fact that the continuous drilling down by first, as Ms. Hillary Clinton during the last elections, when she wanted cheaper medicines and all that. And so these Indian companies have looked at the next molecules going off it in the US and done a huge capex in India. And that capex is going to be over by next year. So the earnings from the pharma sector will continue to be well. So they'll do well. Capex may not be required to that extent further, whereas the revenues will start rising. There are many companies which will see huge earnings in the year 22 onwards. So pharma as a sector is going to be a safe sector, irrespective of which party, who comes to power, whether you have Mr. Trump comes back or it's Biden. IT is another sector in which we have seen that it is impacted because the visa policy can change, the citizen rules change. Now here, India doesn't have to worry. If Trump comes back, it's the same thing, continuation of the existing things, not an issue. If Biden comes, then IT at least will not have any reasons for complaining, because we'll see that a lot of people who are illegal immigrants in China, in US, may be given a citizenship, and it may not then be so harsh on the visas. So Indian IT companies, on the other hand, have learned to live that they have learned to live with the fact that they'll have to hire American people, citizens, for their work, and so they are not so much dependent now on in terms of offshoring. So India IT company is well placed, and at a time when we thought that this crisis which is happening because of the COVID, this will result into some kind of a negative news for these IT, but these companies have really done well for themselves, and to such an extent that they have had the ability to see forward. They have increased confidence to give a guidance which was lacking some 2 quarters back, and more importantly, they are now very, very positive on the longer term outlook, because you cannot make tractors from home, but you can definitely work as an engineer on your computer, and so they can have a higher they can continue to have higher occupancy of work even if there is a situation of COVID continuing for a while. So these two sectors, although they can be impacted, they are more prone, but IT, my sense is much more better placed. Pharma also doesn't have to worry much. So I don't think the earnings of our companies will be impacted by the fact that who comes into the US. Now, aerospace and defense, obviously, each country tries to sell its own products. But the fact is that India is balancing its purchasing. It is not being bullied or allowing it to be bullied by any one country. It makes its purchases as and when it is required, and which is the best in India's interest, and something which India can later on make 100% here over a period of time. So current level of the relationship between the two countries, especially in aerospace and defense, are good. They see it as friends. So I do not see any kind of a negative change as a result of any possible change due to the elections in the US. So we really don't have to worry about it. Next slide, Vete. Now, here is a slide which you can look at. That if you look at Donald Trump, 43% in his tenure, the market is up. Barack Obama, 182.2%. But that was 2 years, two tenures. George Bush minus, but that's because of the fact that you had a 2008 in that. And if you go before that also, you see the Democrat Clinton with two stays in the White House, leads with almost 210% and a 15% CAGR. So while the outward perception is that the Republicans augur really well for the markets, but we've seen that Democrats also have done well. The markets have done well under Democrat leadership as well. So there is no room to worry about as it is. Next slide, Betty. See, our Nifty is at 11,900. Nifty has recovered almost 91.8% of the 4,919 points that it fell from a high of 12,430 that we saw in January 20. It fell to 7,511 on 24th of March. And since risen from bottom, and it has recovered almost 58% risen from the bottom. So essentially, it is no longer a bear market. A bear market is cancelled if you have a recovery of more than 61.8% in the whatever amount that has been lost. If the market recovers that, then it's the end of the bear market. And we have recovered 91.2%. So that's fantastic. It's not a bear market, but we cannot call it a new bull market, because for that we'll have to cross the earlier high, which is of 12,430. That is within a stone's throw from the current level. Okay, so beyond 12,430, it will be a new bull market. Now, how do we see now? Shyam, can we go to the next slide? Now, let's look at the overall situation. The trend in India is towards the number of new cases are continuously declining in India, which augurs really well. At the same time, you have the Prime Minister coming and addressing that one should not let it scar down. That is also essential from the point of view of the fact that this is a fight which we have to carry forward for the next few months. We cannot sit back on our laurels and say that it's gone. In order to ensure that it doesn't come back, we'll have to practice these safe practices of taking steam, taking all the precautions, washing hands, and obviously maintaining the safe distance. Although the second wave of COVID is seen in many European countries, but let's hope it is not so much of a worry. Let's hope it soon boils down. Although the people are saying that experts here have said that India also could face a similar second wave. But the fact that we have, because we ensured a very strict lockdown, the impact on India has been very tough as far as the economic production is concerned, because the lockdown was very tough. So the production has taken a beating, economy has taken a beating, but it also kept a good number of people away from the disease, because we have the advantage of time now to work. We know more about COVID today than what the situation was in the month of March or April. So India has been better able to cope with that. And we hope that we'll have a vaccine in the next year. But there is no doubt about it that things will become better. People might look at the fact that we have had a very negative quarter. We'll have this quarter also negative, and the year also will be a negative growth rate. So what? Things are becoming better, and they'll become better still. There are instances where the international brokers who were looking at India with a suspicious mind have now started increasing their estimates about earnings in 22. So I see this as a good trend. The economic contraction which we have seen is being followed by expansion. So my assessment is that we as investors should be very comfortably placed in terms of buying stocks for the longer term. Can we get a short-term dip? Yes, those can be there. What can be the reason? For instance, suppose Biden comes in and he takes over from January 3rd week, 4th week. But there's next year. So US, they follow a calendar year. And so therefore, there could be some selling by individuals who are worried about higher taxation, because they would want to sell during lower taxation. One. So that could happen. Will it happen? We can't say. But so that could result into some kind of a co-relationship with the our impacts along with the global markets could be impacted. I'm not saying it can happen. It may happen. It will happen. No, it can happen. So let's take it with a pinch of salt as and when it comes. So the borrowing from February after our budget is presented on 1st of Feb, 1 month after that, so maybe from, if you were to look at the markets and willing to, let's say, bid your time for a right level to come in the next 3 months, you may get, you may not get, but it will be a good idea to use any kind of dips to buy. And I do not foresee much problems beyond the month of March. I think the buoyancy will be of a very different order from March of next year. So we believe that it's God's, it's good fortune that our markets have recovered, but all the sectors haven't recovered in equal measure. There are some sectors which have done well. So investors will do very well to have a higher weightage in IT sector stocks, large cap, the mid caps, and also the pharma stocks, because, and some of those chemicals where you have a visibility of earnings. So you may decide on your sector stocks, and then you might want to buy them in tranches. Okay, one third I buy now, one third should it fall, or one third let me buy in the month of Jan. You can divide it over a period of time, you can divide it over a period of in terms of values, or you can simply decide to put your money in the markets over the next 3 months. So it's up to you, but do not be too much worried about these elections, because they will have, I mean, each day has a our market moves, so they will have their implications. But if you have a horizon which is more than four months, beyond 4 months, I think you really don't have to worry about it. So you can take this any kind of blip as an opportunity to get into those stocks which you always wanted to buy and not been able to buy. Thank you, friends. And I'd like to end, and I would now like to take questions if there are any. Shyam, please tell the. Isko aage chalo, aage chalo. Remove this. Go to the next slide. Yeah. Thanks.
Dear participants, to ask any questions, please type on the question mark on your screen and type in your question. I repeat, please click on the question mark on your screen and type in your question. So we have a couple of questions. The first one is from Vinay Shruti. He's asking, can you explain on what basis US print money as against Indian practice or based on gold?
Please come again. On what?
Can you please explain on what basis US prints money as against Indian practice based on gold stocks?
Based on?
So the Indian government prints their money on gold stock. On what basis does US prints money against what collaterals?
Okay. See, in the US, the money is being spent. Even, I mean, the government, the US Fed is there buying even private loans. So that kind of buying is not being done by the Reserve Bank of India here. So we are conservative, and we do not have that kind of a money to burn as well. So India is more conservative, and the US, they can afford to do this, so therefore they are doing. And they have done in the past also. They can also buy equities. So it is not a matter of concern as far as the US is concerned. But mind you, you cannot fight the liquidity. So, and you cannot fight the central banks. We just hope that while in India, we'll have a second series or third series of, let's say, economic action also, where the government may take some steps. But it will not be in such a manner which will make a very big impact. So maybe the government wants to settle in. When you really start seeing the improvement, then perhaps the other steps or money which the government wants to spend will be coming in. But it will be more out of, let's say, target-based things, that you were exporting will give you this, and those kind of things. But that will definitely come once the economy starts picking up.
So we have the second question. How can public be sure that Trump's supposedly anti-China stand is genuine and not just a lip service? As a businessman, he has years of dealing with China.
Yes, we can only say as many in as many words that his public stance is negative. This negative stance can change over a period of time. If he comes with the second term, he may not be as negative. It's not necessary, but it's also not necessary that Biden will be positive towards China. He may not be. But the fact is that the US as a country will fight its own will fight, will ensure that its economy also doesn't suffer. And for that, I think China has to blame. And let's not forget that China is similarly responsible for spreading COVID for the rest of the global world. And it didn't warn in time. It kept on trying to hide it till it was impossible to hide. So there is a global anger against China, which is seen. So therefore, it will be very difficult for Biden also to have a positive outlook, because more than anywhere else, it is the US where a large number of citizens have died, and only because of China.
The next question is, do you think India's manufacturing sector will boom in the future? And India can become a big time exporter to US and UAE.
Our exports as far as manufacturing is concerned is still some far away, but the fact is that we are moving in that direction. The first step that India has taken is ensuring that we become a viable second alternative as far as chemicals are concerned. So there we have already emerged. So we'll see manufacturing in the chemical space by Indian companies. Second, also the companies which are available, you might see companies even from China coming into India and doing their own.
Hello. Dear participant, we are facing some internet connectivity issue. Please hold on. Mr. VK Sharma will be back in 2 minutes. I repeat. We are facing some internet connectivity problems. Please be patient. Mr. VK Sharma will be back in 2 minutes. Dear participants, we are facing internet connectivity issues. Please be patient. We'll be back in 2 minutes. Mr. VK Sharma, can you hear us? Sir, your audio is not audible.
Hamidi, I'm back.
Welcome, sir.
Hello. So
we'll go to the next question.
Yes. Tell me. Tell me,
Sean. Is it a good time to invest in US markets right now, or should one wait for post elections?
I think if you want to invest in the US markets, it's a great opportunity, because should the market stumble, it will be a godsend opportunity to buy. So at this point of time, I think if your account is in place, you could use the any downtrend which could happen to buy. At the same time, it's not necessary. So as Warren Buffett said time and again, that if you were to invest in the S&P 500 or the Nasdaq 100, it will be a great investment, because they'll be able to beat the it will be very difficult to beat S&P 500 or the Nasdaq 100 by the mutual funds, and they charge you so much. So either you do your own equity or you get into these index funds. That is the best alternative, and doing an SIP for the next 3 months is again a good idea in the indices in the US.
Mr. Reddy is asking, what would be the impact of US dollars because of the elections?
Okay. See, in case Trump comes back, then the same situation will continue. There is no change. But if Biden comes, then the fact that there will be lower fiscal deficit, because you will have increased, let's say, tax flows. If that is the situation, it might so happen that you might want to increase that inward taxation, but you will spend more, much more. So you can still have a deficit, but that deficit, higher deficit, will be a qualitatively different one. So I think under Biden, rupee could be, the dollar could become slightly stronger than what it is now.
The pharma is dependent on China supply chain. US mostly has been importer from India. How would be the scene if China retaliates in terms of controlling pharma supply?
See, US, China can hold back the raw material for APIs for a certain period of time. Beyond 6 months or 8 months, it will not be able to impact the rest. It can only impact only for the 6 to 8 months, by the time the cycle of the people is not they do not find alternate sources. So the cost of the cost of making those for getting those raw materials would be higher from other sources, but you will definitely find other sources. So China doesn't want to kill its golden goose. So there is no way it will stop the things from coming to India. But if at all it comes, India will also take its position in terms of either producing all the material inward here or sourcing it from expensive places, but not depending upon China. It'll take some time, but if China takes that stand, then obviously we'll be able to we'll be forced to ensure that we do more research on our APIs or the raw materials and source it or from other sources so that we are not dependent upon China. But as I foresee, China cannot become very harsh in its policies, because doesn't supply the raw material to India, where are the other things which are going to be made of? So it will be very difficult for China to really able to, let's say, sell its product elsewhere also. So I think it's a case in which it's a clear situation which will emerge in the next 3-4 years, and in this clarity we are seeing that ultimately we could see China going down in its value in terms of the fact that it could break up into many pieces, as the global watchers have been saying, the US strategic investors, US strategic sell also has also been saying, and the rest of the people are also saying that you could see breaking up of China and Pakistan into several pieces in the coming 5-6 years.
So we'll take one last question.
Yes,
from Mr. Vishal Bhatia. He's asking which sectors are the best to invest right now and which sectors to avoid.
Okay. I think IT is the best sector to put in your money right now, and there is no sector to avoid at this point of time, because the sectors like let's say picture halls and airlines, they are the ones which are at the bottom, but they will do well as and when normalcy returns. So there is no sector to avoid at this point of time, but I would want investors to be pay a premium and be in large caps, in IT and in pharma, where there's visibility of earnings, and not fall for something fancy or something which is running behind the stock. I wouldn't want to our investors to do that. So it's good to look at TCS, Infosys, HCL Tech, and those kind of companies.
Thank you, sir, for your time. I think we have completed all the questions that we have. Thank you for your time. Any closing remarks, sir?
Yeah, see, friends, this is a developing story. So all days, people, markets can change their course even before the election outcome based upon expectations. And they can say that this was expected and may not fall even if this somebody else comes. So let's take this step one by one and day by day, and invest for the longer term. And if in case there are hiccups in the next 3 months, we should take it as a godsend opportunity.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, and thank you, friends, for joining us.